want to do is look at the principles that we found. And we want to think about relevance. Yesterday, a number of people talked about that they want to cross to be relevant. They want to be able to inspire them. They want to be able to find something they can apply from the class. In fact, application is the main reason that we are teaching. Even if we're talking about inspiration, if we inspire people but they can't do anything with that inspiration, it's not very helpful. In fact, it can be frustrating. If you've ever been really inspired about something but you had no idea what to do with your inspiration, it can often be more frustrating than if you weren't inspired at all, isn't it? Right? Wow, I want to... I didn't know where to start, and then you actually get depressed. So what we want to do is we want to have some sort of application. Now, any principle we come up with must have application. By definition, a principle is something that has universal application. At the same time, not all principles are going to be that relevant to all audiences at all times. So this step does involve knowing something about one's audience. And that is a whole other topic which we might have time to talk about tomorrow in our advanced class, and that is, how do we find out about our audience? How do we find out about the people we're speaking to? You know, it does happen, it certainly happened to me, that I prepared a class for one audience and ended up being faced with a very different audience. That has definitely happened. Yeah, I'm sure it's happened to you too, right? You know, you're already, sometimes you put a lot of...
Like every day.
Like every day, sometimes you put a lot of time and energy and you're thinking, you know, this is going to be suitable. And sometimes the person who plans the reason it happens to me is that as I travel, other people often are the ones planning my speaking engagements. And often those people don't have a sense about audience. They're thinking about what they want to communicate rather than what the audience is able or interested in hearing. And so they'll want me to speak on a topic that's like their pet topic. So that's generally how it happens, that there's this mismatch. But you want to think about your audience. So for this next point that we're going to do, please have some particular audience in mind. So get some audience in mind. And for this practice session, don't make it too difficult. Some audiences are extremely difficult. You know, a Sunday Feast class in Soho Street in London is a very difficult audience. Because you have people who've been practicing Christian consciousness for 40 years, and you have people who just walked in off the street, and everybody knew them. And they're all in the same audience. So that's not that common, even in a Sunday Feast class, depends where you are in the world. But so sometimes you have this audience that's this huge range of background and understanding, and we'll try to talk about that tomorrow also, what we do with a very mixed audience. But for right now, assume that you do know the audience. Make up some audience for yourself. And then think about which of the principles that you found would have a practical, immediate, real-life application to that audience. Now, when you're thinking about application, you want to think about what people's needs are. In one sense, we can say that all human beings have the same set of generic needs. And psychologists, sociologists can give you a list of human needs. Those sort of lists are very helpful, especially if you have no idea what your audience is going to be like. You can always aim at one of those universal generic needs. For example, what's a universal generic need that all human beings have?
Appreciation.
Appreciation. Everybody wants to be appreciated. We actually need to be appreciated.
Happiness.
Love.
Food.
Well, nourishing food. Some sort of shelter, physical shelter, emotional shelter,
understanding.
Non-transparent.
Authenticity, yes.
Acceptance.
Connectedness, yes.
Peace.
Peace, yes. Some sort of self-esteem, self-concept, we could say autonomy. Usually the word that's used for that is autonomy. It's just, you know, people might put something funny on that, but yes.
Competence.
Huh?
Competence.
Competence, yes. So these are universal, there's more than that, but these are universal needs, a need for meaning, a need for joy and play. So these are basic, all living entities have these needs, and they're especially prominent in human beings. You know, even the soul in a little plant has a need for meaning, but it's not very aware of that. So you can always go to those. But each group of people expresses those deep needs in some sort of specific way. So if I'm dealing with people, say, age 14 to 16, they're going to feel those needs for connectedness and meaning and autonomy and authenticity and play a little differently than if I'm speaking to people age 60 to 70. You know, or if I'm speaking to people who have young children, they're going to feel those needs in a different way than people who are single and don't have any children. So your audience does express those needs differently. Or if I'm speaking to people who are already practicing Krishna consciousness. Just yesterday I had a conversation with a devotee who said, you know, I was talking to this person who, you know, seems to be part of the Hare Krishna movement, but isn't really involved in practicing bhakti. And therefore, when I made some statements about surrender to Krishna, taking shelter of Krishna, I could see that she couldn't really relate to what I was talking about. It just didn't mean anything to her, didn't resonate with her. So also how we present people's needs depends on the audience. Does that make sense to everybody? Right? Just like I noticed at the recent wedding where we had a lot of people who've been practicing Krishna consciousness for decades, as well as people, this was probably their very first time interacting with Hare Krishna devotees. And so people were presenting things in a way that people could relate to, even though we may have been accessing the same need. Everybody follow this? Yes? Okay, so think of who you want your audience to be. Look at your principles and think, all right, well, what felt need in my audience could this principle have an application that would meet that felt need? Now, I was once asked to give a talk to children, and the topic I was asked to speak on was how to respect your parents more. I refused. I said, I'm not giving that talk. Because I said, the children are waking up in the morning thinking, how can I be more respectful to my parents? You know, we can talk about that. If they were more respectful to their parents, it would fulfill their needs for connection and appreciation and meaning. But they wouldn't see it that way. You know, they feel they have a need to get their parents to listen to them. So if I gave a talk on how to get your parents to listen to you, they would be very interested. So I might be going for the same underlying need of connectivity and appreciation, but I'd be doing it through their felt need. Everybody follow this? Which is going to be a little different. So think about your audience. Think about what needs are they feeling that they have? And how could this which universal principle that you found would have the most obvious, most clear, and most aha way of applying it to help them meet their need? And then pick that as the principle you're going to use to plan your class. Choose one of your principles based on the audience that you decided that you would be speaking to. going to be to write our conclusion. But before we do that, I want to really emphasize that in every class, you should only pick one principle to speak about. Only one principle. Only one principle. How many principles?
One.
One. How many? One. Well, anybody have any idea why only one? Why can't I talk about five principles in my class?
It's perfect.
Huh?
It will, if we speak about several principles, we disperse. We cannot be focused on our topic.
Yes. And what will happen to your audience?
They'll be confused.
They'll be confused. You want people to walk away with clarity. And you might say, but there's so many important things. Trust God that people will get to hear about those other things at another time. The worst class that I attended in the Hare Krishna movement was the Sunday feast class where the speaker decided that he was going to preach the entire Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita in one class. He ended up teaching nothing. And had I known what a terrible class it was, bless you, beforehand, I would have recorded it and used it as an example, but it was just... And he said things like, so Krishna is the same, you know, when we say Krishna's name, there is just like, you know, materially when we say water, water, and Krishna is the taste of water, and... And he just never finished anything, you know, he just started all these things and left them hanging. Because he had too many things he wanted to say. And then what happens when the speaker rambles all over the universe is we just come out and like, You know, maybe we were entertained. Maybe it was a good delivery, it was entertaining. We might come out with one sentence from the class that was useful to us. But overall, it's not going to have that transformative, inspirational application effect that we want. Now, having said that you pick one principle, on an advanced level, you can bring in as sub-points other principles that are in the verse in the purport. But please don't try that in your first morning. So after you've been giving classes for a while and you're really expert, you can find often, and that's the most fun for me, when I can bring everything in under one heading. I'm like, oh, I caught every single point here, but I put it all under one principle. But that's not something that you can do in every class. I mean, especially some verses and purports, you look at them and you go, there's so much here, and there's no way at all that I can fit everything under one principle. There's going to be parts, there's going to be really important, wonderful parts of this verse and purport that I'm just not going to touch on at all. So, yes?
How do you choose that? The main principle that you want to talk about.
How to choose the main principle? You have to think about who is my
audience.
What is one felt need of my audience? And of the principles I've identified, which of the principles I've identified has some natural application to meeting this audience's felt need. I mean, for example, the verse I spoke about this morning was about the fact that the child belongs to the father. It was about the responsibility of fathers. And Prabhupada talked in the purport about how Krishna is the supreme father. He talked about how that the Krishna provides for everyone. He talked about that scarcity comes from being spiritually diseased. So now let's say that I was giving that class to a group of biological fathers. So I would have picked a principle, although I did talk about biological fathers in my class, but I wasn't organizing the class around that principle because that wasn't my audience. I didn't have a group of people that were waking up in the morning with, how can I be a better father? I mean, there might have been two people in the audience like that. And of course, I can't tell who's listening over the internet. And I certainly can't tell who's going to be listening to this 5 years from now. That's one problem with recordings. You you know, you just, you have a, when you have a recorded class or a broadcast class, you have an audience of which you have no awareness at all. You know, especially, it's especially disconcerting, you know, when I go somewhere and I meet someone I've never met before and they said, I've been listening to your classes for the last 5 years. So these classes go out over space and time. But I always gear the class to the people in front of me. People who are listening, you know. Right? Well, those of you who are listening to this class 5 years from now. But, you know, you want to tailor it for that group. So I felt for the group that I was speaking to this morning, their felt need was much more, how do I relate to Krishna in my life? That was much more the people that I was dealing with, the people that were here this morning. The people that come to a Bhagavatam class in Radhadesh tend to be seriously practicing devotees. Who are, you know, they're thinking, how can I have my connection with Krishna? How can I get my connection with Krishna? How can I get my connection with Krishna? And they're not so much concerned about social issues in the world and irresponsible fathers and insulted mothers, and, which was also very much part of the person. But that, I don't think that was their primary. Felt need. So you want to pick a principle where you can get a connection, the connection between what people are waking up concerned about and how the principle can be applied to solve that problem is the clearest to you. Now, all of us have concerns during our day, yeah? Yes? We have things that occupy us as something that we need to do in order to get our needs met. And what we want to see is how some eternal Krishna conscious principle provides the key to getting our need met. And we're going to access that through what the person is already concerned about. So most people in the world do not wake up in the morning thinking, how can I be more connected with Krishna, the cowherd boy? I hazard that even most people in the Hare Krishna movement don't necessarily wake up with that as their primary. So if we give a class the title, which, how can you connect more with Krishna, the cowherd boy, that's not going to be of that much interest to them. But we can provide that as the solution to whatever they're feeling their need is. So if their need is, you know, how can I get better grades on my exam? How can I get my kid to behave? How can I have more money? How can I deal with my mind? How do I deal with my difficult boss? How do I find a life partner? I mean, these are the kind of things that are weighing on people. Yes? And yet, according to the audience, according to the demographic, you're going to have different manifestations of that. All of those anxieties represent some sort of universal need. And all universal needs are ultimately spiritual. Therefore, all universal needs can be solved by some sort of spiritual principle. This is something I literally could talk about for a week. So I'm really just giving kind of codes here. Now, I do have an extended series of classes on how to get to class, and we talk about finding, identifying people's felt needs, and then going from there toward the deeper needs, and how do we develop an application, a practical application that helps people to meet their needs. So I'm not giving you the details on this now. But at least I'm giving you the concepts that's how you want to choose your principle. Yes?
What will be the difference between universal needs and principles?
A principle is a statement of universal truth. It's a statement A universal need is just a word, generally. So the ultimate spiritual need, like Prabhupada said, the need of the soul is for freedom. So it's just a word, freedom. What are the eternal, non-contextual principles that will fulfill your need for freedom? Those can be stated as a declarative sentence. So, I mean, for example, this verse in purport, we could certainly isolate a principle that would fulfill people's need for freedom. Couldn't we? Because this was about Maya. Yes? We could find principles here, and many of you did, that would fulfill people's need for meaning, because it was a lot about how Maya was nonsensical, which would imply that the opposite of Maya is sensible and provides meaning. But again, most people aren't thinking, shh, I need freedom, I need meaning. Some people do, but generally we don't think in terms of those transcendent needs. We think about, well, I wish I could have flexible hours of work. What are we at? We're looking for freedom. Does that make sense, everybody? Mm-hmm. You know, I wish that what I did during the day was more satisfying to me. What are we looking for? Meaning. But that's not the way it comes into our mind. Is everybody following that? Mm-hmm. Yes? Okay. I think how much more I can do in the next 15 minutes. All right, so now that you've decided on the principle that you're going to take, the next thing is the conclusion. So this is your bridge between this non-contextual universal principle and what we're calling the felt need of your audience. What is it you want them to do? Now, do doesn't necessarily have to be a physical action. It could be a change in mentality, it could be a change in emotion, a new way of looking at things. It could be a subtle action, it doesn't necessarily have to be a physical action. But you want your audience to make some sort of change. That when they make this change, their felt need will at least begin to be met. Okay, so if you could think about what you'd like that to do, what do you want them to do? Now, you can, first of all, you can write this down in a general way. But we do want to have some level of specificity. But you can have to start this with a general way. Again, based on the principle that you've chosen. And all of us have a felt need. for food that we find nourishing and tasty and satisfying that we can digest. Yes? That we're certain about that. We don't have to guess any age, any gender, any marital status. We know that. So suppose we have the principle, the general principle. What general principle would meet that need spiritually? That's a detail.
Charity? Vegetarism?
That's a sub.
The principle is the universal law, right?
Yes.
And what universal law can apply to a person?
The most nourishing food is food that has been offered to the Lord. So let's say I've already convinced my audience that that's true. Right? I've convinced them that that's true. And now what are they going to do about it? What are they going to do about it? What could be a step? So that depends on who your audience is. So let's say your audience is people who are very new to bhakti. You could say, we have some cookbooks here. You could take any one of those cookbooks, pick a recipe that you know that you could complete in a reasonable amount of time with the ingredients you have at home. Try making it and making a simple offering to Krishna and see how differently you feel about the food that you eat. That would be an application. Now, if I'm talking to people who are already offering their food to Krishna, then we could talk about a mood. So the next time we offer food to Krishna, could we think about how Krishna is actually eating it? Could we maybe meditate on how, you know, Krishna is out in the forest with his friends and he's eating the food that's sent for him, and he's sharing it with his cowherd boys? Or if you're offering him morning time, you could meditate about how Lord Chaitanya and Lord Chaitanya are coming home after a long day on Sankirtan. And they're eating what you're offering. Right, so we're giving some practical application. Or maybe most of you in Radhadesh never cook, maybe you just eat. So if I'm talking to people who just eat prasadam but never cook it, you know, a lot of temple devotees, they may not go in the kitchen. We may not be making an offering, or very rarely. So we can talk about how we feel about eating the prasadam, what's our mood with eating what's been offered to Krishna. That's a practical application. And you want to make it big enough so that everybody can relate to it. If we just talk about Krishna Balaram eating in the forest, some people might not count. But they might be able to relate to morning time. Or they might be able to relate to offering to their guru. So you want to give people a few varieties so that you're going to hit everybody. And you don't want to make it too specific. I mean, one example I can tell you of something too specific was a devotee who said, and everyone should read Srila Prabhupada's books for 2 hours a day. I said, that's way too specific. You can challenge people. Can we make a plan to increase either the quality or the quantity of our connection with Prabhupada's books? Or both? Maybe that's going to mean, maybe if we're not reading anything, maybe it'll mean a verse a day. Maybe it'll mean increasing the number of books you read, or the number of verses you read, or maybe it'll mean increasing your study habits, or making your study habits more personal. So you want to say, what do you want people to do? Write down, what do you want people to do? Again, it might be mental. It might be a mood. Yes?
For example, if some people doesn't like to read, how can we bring them?
Well, then we can also say, or you could listen to an audio book. But let's say, you know, I like the principle you took that that Maya was uncomfortable with her service. And we might have people have may have felt need of what do I do when I have to do a service with which I don't feel comfortable. Especially when it's a service where we have to correct other people, because that's why Maya is uncomfortable. She's correcting other people, and also she's uncomfortable because she's often giving people something that's not direct bhakti. And you know, sometimes we have to do that too, even as devotees. My Prabhupada sometimes would say to people, if you're going to eat cows, at least eat cows that have died naturally. Or if you want to eat meat, you eat a goat. That's not direct bhakti. But he would sometimes say that to people, yes? So sometimes we may have to instruct people in ways that are not direct bhakti, or we may have to correct people, and we may feel uncomfortable about that. So what could we do to still see that as a service? How can we deal with that so that we can still connect with Krishna in that uncomfortable situation? And you can give people something to do. What is it that if I chose that as my principle, what would I want people to walk out of class saying, yes, this is what I'm going to do?
So you're contextualizing the non-contextual.
Bingo. And you're contextualizing the non-contextual principle in a way that includes action, not just an idea. You are going to do it in an idea, and obviously you're going to have to do that tomorrow. Tomorrow I'm going to have to come back. I thought I'd finish that today, but it's not going to happen. So everybody should have written down what you want your audience to do. So what we're going to do tomorrow is we're going to take you through some of these intermediate steps, because what you want the audience to do is what you're going to present at the end of your class. And that's going to be after you've convinced them that the principle is true on a universal scale, and then convince them that it's true for them. So I'm going to go through tomorrow how to do that. How will we convince people that the principle is true? Well, actually, three things. How to get people's attention in the beginning of the class. How to convince them that the principle is true in a non-contextual form, which always needs to be done first because that's not threatening. And also, if people don't understand and accept that it's true in general, they'll never accept that it's true for themselves. So first, we want to get people's attention. If you don't get people's attention in the first few minutes of the class, you'll never recapture it for most people. Then you want to convince them that the principle is true in a general way. Again, I'm not going to accept that it's true for myself unless I accept that it's true in general. And accepting that something is true in general is much easier. You know, because when I accept that something is true in general, I'm not really thinking about myself. It's just, that's true.
No threat.
Yeah, it's not threatening. And then, how to convince them that it's true for themselves, which is the most difficult thing to do in a class, but the most essential. Because if people don't think the principle is true for themselves, they won't want to do what you're asking them to do. And then the thing that you end with is what you're asking them to do. So why, when the end of the class is what we're asking them to do I ask you to think of that first? Because everything else you're doing in the class has to go towards that. That's your goal. Your goal is that everyone in the class makes some sort of a commitment. And therefore, you're structuring everything in the class to lead to that point. And if you don't know where you're trying to get people to go, the rest of your class will be basically useless. Everybody understand the logic of that? Yes. I'm trying to lead people step by step to a particular conclusion. And again, where you want people to go, what you want people to do, it needs to be specific enough so that people are not just like, I have to connect with Krishna more, what does that mean? But it's also got to be broad enough so that each person can find their own application. So you're not dictating to people exactly what they have to do. Dictating to people very, very specifically as to what they have to do violates our principle of personals. You know, everyone's going to find their own individual, unique application, but you want to give them, it's sort of this balance you're going between general and specific. All right, so we'll go through those steps tomorrow. And if you can please bring this work with you tomorrow. Okay, so bring what you've done. And I'm going to start tomorrow with just asking just a few people, what principle did you pick, what's your audience, and where do you want them to go? What do you want them to do by the end of the class? All right. And this is, of course, with what we were talking about with mood yesterday. So hopefully everything you did today involved the mood that we spent a lot of time, spent about half the class yesterday talking. And if the delivery is not very good, even if your message is very good, people will not hear it. Now, I mean, if delivery is not very good, you're expecting that everyone in your audience is extremely, extremely eager and sincere. You're putting a very big burden on the audience to have an exciting message that's delivered without us. So, you know, if you really want to be nourished in our food, then you should offer to Krishna. So, you know, the next time you eat, you might want to think about it. Okay, and if anyone, also tomorrow, hopefully, we will have time for a number of the advanced topics. So, if I ask a number of you to make notes about some of the things you wanted to bring up that were advanced topics. And if any of you have any other points that you'd like me to cover, I'm hoping that we will have at least 15 or 20 minutes for that talk.
I thought if we don't have enough time, we can always move to the slideshow in the lobby, a microphone, but if you want to finish it, we could go there.
No.
If you haven't finished it, okay.
No, because I'm leaving early Friday and I have some things to do tomorrow night. Nice setting up. All right, so I hope this was all helpful. And any of you who just come today, I've still given you. That's another brief thing I should mention, is that when you do teach a multi-part class, do think, will people walk away with something valuable even if they only go to one part? Thank you very much.
J'ai une pièce de cette classe.
Si, si, mon bien. Le principal, c'est les idées qu'elle a données sont bonnes. C'est de trouver. Quand on donne des conférences en français, des fois les gens ne sont pas intéressés. Ils viennent ici, ils écoutent une conférence, mais ce n'est pas forcément ce qui les intéresse eux, c'est ce que celui qui donne la conférence a envie de dire. Pour souder un groupe, il ne faut pas faire une conférence sur un tel sujet. Il faut d'abord interroger le groupe, savoir sur quoi ils veulent qu'on parle, et les impliquer avec des principes généraux et générateurs. Tu vois ? Et ici, par exemple, tu donnes une conférence et les gens, ils écoutent. Ça les intéresse, ça ne les intéresse pas. Mais par contre, si tu sais bien vos francophones, voilà un sujet qu'on peut parler, comment développer et comment impliquer les gens de tous les milieux sur une idée générale qui peut focaliser et à laquelle on peut faire adhérer les gens. Pour être plus près de Krishna. C'est ça l'idée principale.
Ah! Madhu, 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 Madh Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. class in half an hour.
Thank you.
Yeah.